মোর শ্রী বিয়ার্ড স্বামী প্রভানন্দজি মহারাজ, স্বামী ভজনানন্দজি মহারাজ, মোর শ্রী বিয়ার্ড স্বামী গৌতমানন্দজি মহারাজ, রিভিয়ার্ড সর্বলোকানন্দজি মহারাজ, আদার রিভিয়ার্ড অ্যান্ড ডিয়ার মংস অ্যান্ড ব্রহ্মচারিন্স ইন দি অডিয়েন্স, রেসপেক্টেড নানস and the representatives of member ashramas of the Bhava Prachar Parishads. The topic of the discussion we know, Swami Vivekananda in the light of 150 years. Actually, more than 150 years have passed since he was born. And I prefer to count from 1893, the year he participated in the World's Parliament of Religions in Chicago. Because from that time only, he became known to the people at large. So during the 120 years, a little more than 20 years, Swamiji has influenced and inspired innumerable lives in India and abroad. Let us take the case of Netaji Subhash here. He was then a boy of only 15. Came across a book, most probably it was a copy of Swamiji's Indian lectures, lectures from Colombo to Almora. He read a few pages and then and there itself, he decided what will be the future course of his life. Another incident, another example. A Western lady, she is weeping after listening to Swamiji's speech. When she was asked the reason, she said, "He has given me eternal life. So far, she used to think in the usual way that she was a puny creature limited to birth and death. After listening to Swamiji, she realized that she was the divine self, immortal and infinite. No discovery about your identity can be more glorious than this." In fact, this was the mission of Swami Vivekananda. He once wrote to Nivedita in a letter in other languages. This was his mission, to provide a divine identity to everybody, to provide a divine meaning to every activity of life. Now, how did Swami Vivekananda appear to those who came in his close contact? Sister Christine, one of his Western disciples, says about Swami Vivekananda, "He was love personified, he was all love." And Miss MacLeod, another disciple, Western disciple, she says, "He was all strength." Actually, Swamiji was both. And he instills in his followers both love and strength. While describing what should be the characteristic of an ideal monk, Swamiji says, "A monk will be as strong as strength itself. Still, he will have a woman's heart." So love and strength. If we are to follow Swamiji, we have to claim that we are right kind of followers of Swamiji, we must have at least these two qualities: love for God, love for man, and strength, mental, spiritual, and in addition to that, physical strength also. We all know that his message was not only for India, but also for the world at large. In her introductory speech, in her introduction to Swamiji's complete works, Sister Nivedita describes Swamiji's message as "world's heal all," meaning that his message contains cure for all maladies of mankind. Words heal all. His participation at Chicago Parliament of Religions was a turning point in our national history. Sri Aurobindo says that this was the first visible sign that India is awake, and she was awake, not only to survive but also to conquer. And we all know this is now an established fact, that from this followed India's struggle for independence, and which was greatly influenced by Swamiji's deeds and works. Leaders like Netaji Subhash, Mahatma Gandhi and Sri Aurobindo, and also the rank and file of this freedom movement, were very much influenced by Swami Vivekananda. So much so that Lord Ronald Say, whenever he would come across a young man who was arrested, he would ask this first question, just the stock question he would ask: are you a Vedantin? Are you a follower of Vivekananda? If the answer was in the affirmative, the surveillance will be more. That particular young man will be suspected more. A very interesting statement we find in a book by an historian, which was published from National Education Council, from the Education Council of West Bengal, a few years after the independence. You will find this statement quoted in Revered Swami Prabhanandaji's article in the Bengali anthology, Chintanaya Vivekananda. He says, how pervasive was his influence in pre-independence India, that he, in a very interesting statement, he explains. He says, Atin Bosu, he says, Vivekananda did not die in 1902. He lived at least till 1947 with Gandhi and Bosch, closes the epoch which he had started. A new chapter has begun. Only the future will show whether his soul will die now or it will reincarnate to spiritualize the nation. Surely his soul has not gone to rest. It seems more active now, especially after the tremendous enthusiasm we have observed during the last 4 years over the 150th birth anniversary of Swami Vivekananda. It is quite evident, that is the pointer to the fact that Swami Vivekananda is still alive, he is still active, more active. Also, if we consider the main policies of all the governments that ruled in India since independence, we find that they have centered around more or less these main issues. Issues of poverty of common people, their education and nutrition, women empowerment and the like. These are the issues we know which Swamiji repeatedly mentioned and discussed in his Indian lectures that he delivered immediately on his triumphant return from the West. So we can say that Swamiji is still relevant, and he is emerging more relevant every day. Among our national leaders, it was Swamiji alone who placed a national goal before the country. What was that goal? To establish an ideal society first in India, and then to set that model before the world also. Swamiji says that truth does not pay homage to any society. Society has to pay homage to truth. That society is the greatest where the highest truths are made practical. This society where the highest truth, by highest truth, when Swamiji says it, it cannot but be the spiritual truth. A kind of society, we have not yet found such society. Never in the history an ideal society ever was a reality. And this is the first time it would be going to take place, following Sri Ramakrishna, Sharada Devi and Vivekananda. We should not think, from Nivedita we know that Swamiji was not for the repetition of our glorious future. He was for a future for this country that would far outshine our glorious past, the past that produced Upanishads, the past that produced the epics like Ramayana and Mahabharata, the past, the very glorious past that produced Rajarshis like Janakas. Even that glorious past will seem insignificant when that real India will be a reality. Nivedita said, the India of Swamiji's dream lay in the future. So that is the national goal, a goal he has placed before our country, as a nation as a whole. Why not yet, never this ideal society had been established yet? Because we have never considered religion as a positive factor in society. Religion in its own way has influenced society, but never have we considered to use religion for the sake of building a society. There is surely much point in its favor why religion was not used, because religion in its previous forms, religion was never an equal blessing to all. It was blessing to a particular community, whereas it was a horrible curse for the others. So only after the advent of Sri Ramakrishna we have seen a benign face of religion, which is benign for everybody in all circumstances. Swamiji's mantra for an ideal society was this: Western science coupled with Vedanta. If Swamiji was to utter this now, I think he would not use the word Western, because science is no longer the monopoly of the West only. He would have used science coupled with Vedanta. Science to take care of external world and religion to take care of the inner world. We would have both the wealth of the external world and the wealth of the heart. Combining both, an ideal society will be first formed in India, then the whole world will follow us. Swamiji said that the future society would be neither Western nor Eastern. It would be a common human society. When this will be accomplished, an ideal society world over with spirituality in its due role, when this will be possible, we'll be in a position to say that Ramakrishna movement has reached its fulfillment. But this is not possible without this third order of Ramakrishna movement, which our revered Vice President Maharaj said. He gave this name to this member ashram of the Bhapa Prachar Parishad. We must work out it together. We have the same motto, same goal, same ideal. Whenever Swamiji would encourage anybody, he would say that we have done a wonderful job, but we have to do still better. Our sentiments about these member ashrams of the Bhapa Prachar Parishad also is the same. We have been doing commendable work throughout the countries, but we expect much more than that. We want to see great karmayogins among you who'd be running as efficiently like us, the Ramakrishna, even more. The hospitals like Seva Pratishthans, educational institutions like Narendrapur or Coimbatore, we want that. Along with that, we want also spiritual giants like Rangmasai, M, appearing among you, who'll be remain in society as living inspirations to many others. Swamiji used to say that by following Thakur, the householders, the Bhava Prachar Parishad ashramas are not mostly householders, but there are nuns and monks also, but mostly they are householders. That is why I use these words. That Swamiji says that by following Thakur and the holy trio, the householder's life will be so elevated that a time will come when the human babies will be born with yogic qualities itself. So we can imagine what a great expectation Swamiji had of these private ashramas. We pray and sincerely hope that you would make Swamiji happy, you would not fail him. Thank you.